Hello and welcome to Mangator 96, and today we have the review of One Piece chapter 1020, titled Robin vs. Black Maria. The title of this chapter is a bit misleading, as what we got in this chapter was a verbal fight between Black Maria and Robin, as opposed to a physical one. Despite Robin only having a verbal confrontation with Black Maria in this chapter, it was still good, as we got some good character moments from her in this chapter, with her even getting the Luffy will be the Pirate King line as a cherry on top. While this chapter was more of a setup for the actual Robin vs. Black Maria finale, this chapter still had some nice action, with a big revelation of this chapter being Yamato's Devil Fruit, where Oda once again surprised everyone with his choice. And for the finale of this chapter, he got told on how Luffy will re-enter the fight with Kaido. Now, let's save all that for later and start at the beginning of this week's chapter. On the cover this week, we have Denjiro, who is nibbling on his fake pompadour while dreaming of eating a giant shrimp tempura. Going into the contents of this week's chapter, we start right where the last chapter ended on, with Kaido telling us the name of Yamato's Devil Fruit, and it's a mythical dog-dog fruit type Makami. With this, after laying to rest the Byakko theories, Oda continues to also lay to rest the Kirin theories that were the most popular in the last 2 weeks. And with Oda going the Makami route, which I really didn't see anybody mention as a possibility in the last 2 weeks, he showed once again that he is capable of surprising everyone with his choices. As for what a Makami is, Makami is a defecation of a Japanese wolf which is now extinct. Makami has traditionally been worshipped as a sacred beast, having eaten many people, an old wolf living in Makahaminora of Asuka area in Yamato province, present-day Nara prefecture. Was defined for his ferocity and worshipped as a guardian deity who would protect crops against wild boars and deer. Makami was worshipped as a deity who would understand human words, know the nature of each human being, protect the good and punish the wicked. Makami was regarded as having a strong power to protect people against evil, particularly against such hardships as caused by fire and robbery. As time passed, however, and humans began expanding their sphere of life into mountainous regions, the concept of wolves attacking domestic animals spread, and it is said that the sacredness of Makami fell into decline as the number of wolves decreased. From this description, it's easy to see why Kaido refers to the Makami as the guardian deity of Wano, which could possibly be a reason for Yamato not to join the Straw Hats at the end of Wano, as he has the duty as the Makami protect Wano, which he acknowledges in this chapter with him stating that it is his duty to free Wano from Kaido's rule. It is not shown what special ability the Makami possesses in this chapter, but what is shown that Yamato can shoot breath attacks on the level of Kaido's Boro breath, which we see a collision of those two attacks ending in a tie, and with Yamato and Kaido glaring at each other, we end this family dispute for this chapter at least. Then we move to the main focus of this chapter, with the fight Robin and Brook vs. Black Maria. Right off the gate, we see some familiar faces that we haven't seen since Robin's flashback. The faces being Robin's mom, Nico Olivia, Professor Clover and Jaguar D. Sol, who all call for Robin to come to them as they haven't seen each other in decades. At first it seems that Robin is falling for this obvious trap as she is going towards them with tears in her eyes, making Brook sweat even if he doesn't have skin. But Brook's worry is unnecessary, as Robin just acted so she could come close to the enemies before attacking them. That way, Robin sends flying two snake smile users and one number named Kun Kyun. That way, again raising the question, what was the point of the numbers in the first place? Beside their origin of being failed experiments of ancient giants at Punk Hazard, there weren't a threat at all so far, with Luffy, Franky and Drake one-shotting each one, and now Robin not one-shotting Kun Yun. But if the two would ever go into a fight, Robin could defeat her pretty easily, I'm sure of that. Moving on from this, those three that got bitch slapped by Robin just now mentioned how Black Maria's illusions don't seem to work on Robin and Brooke, which raises the question, how does Black Maria create those illusions in the first place? Has it something to do with her devil fruit power, or is it something else? Considering that those illusions didn't work, I doubt that Black Maria will be using them going forward in her fight with Robin, so we'll probably won't be getting an answer on how she's creating those illusions in the main story, but maybe we'll get the answer in an SBS or Weaver card in the future. After this little trap didn't work, Black Maria decides to attack directly, but before she can attack, Brooke and Robin have a little bonding moment between them, discussing the illusions a minute ago and how they weren't affected by it, bonding over the fact that both of them had countless similar dreams over the years and they know for a fact that those people are dead and that they aren't coming back. That way, they weren't affected by Black Maria's illusions. Black Maria interrupts this bonding between Robin and Brooke by attacking them, where Oda once again flexes on his smile user designs. When you thought that you've seen it all with those cursed smile users, Oda just one-ups himself each time, this time giving us the Pax smile fruit. Black Maria's weapon that resembled the yokai Wanyudo is in actuality just a giant face with a Pax body in the wheel that can start fires somehow, making the wheel burn. It is not clear how he does it. I would assume that the wheel itself has some mechanism that allows Wanyudo to start the fires. Either way, the only thing that is certain here is that Wanyudo is a poor bastard that really did pull the short straw with those smile fruits. I'd rather eat a defect smile fruit than end up as this poor bastard. Moving on, Black Maria catches up, forcing both Robin and Brooke to jump into the air to avoid her flame wheel attacks. Robin uses her spider net to cling to the ceiling like Black Maria does while carrying Brooke in her arms. If nothing else, Brooke is just a pile of bones, so he shouldn't be a burden for Robin to carry. Then we get the start of Robin's and Black Maria's verbal fight in this chapter. While Robin can't understand Black Maria starting big fires in a wooden castle so easily, that way endangering her allies. While Black Maria can't understand why Robin is worried about her enemies in the first place. Brooke interrupts by showing us a new power of his, and that's that he can freeze a person just by using his soul alone without the help of his blade. That way he freezes the poor Wanyudo. For Wanyudo's sake, I hope he stays frozen for all eternity. By freezing Wanyudo, Black Maria has lost her means of creating fire anymore, which leaves only the fire that she started previously to be taken care of. Brooke extinguishes the flames by using his sword. That way he created the perfect stage for Robin's one-on-one with Black Maria. But before they start fighting, Black Maria doesn't miss her opportunity to try and shake up Robin mentally by going on how she is targeted by every big shot in the world for her abilities to read the poneglyphs, and that she is just a burden on her crew. This would have definitely worked on Robin in Water 7, but not on this one. So Black Maria needs to find another way to shake Robin up. She starts to make fun of Sanji's display when he called for Robin's help, but that only backfires on her as she clearly has no idea who Sanji is as a person and what that meant for him to call for Robin's help. But Robin and Brooke certainly do know what that meant. Brooke leaves Robin so she can have her one-on-one with Black Maria while he goes to deal with her minions, including Kunyun and the two snake smile users from the beginning of this chapter. Meanwhile, Robin prepares to face off Black Maria, but before she does, she has a Luffy will be the Pirate King moment, where she also includes Sanji in it, telling Black Maria that Sanji is one of the wings that will help the Pirate King fly. This is a bit different than what the other Straw Hat said, where they explicitly said that Luffy is the man that will become the Pirate King. Nonetheless, it's a nice moment for Robin, and her adding Sanji's name into it is a nice touch on her part. to shut Black Maria's mouth. The last thing we see of this is Robin creating a giant doppelganger of her with a bunch of giant hands sprawling out of the ground. So the speculation that Robin could create a giant clone of her were correct, and it seems that this is her strongest attack that she has, so it will be interesting to see what she does with it, probably in the next chapter. The only other noteworthy thing from this scene is that her upper body of the clone is completely naked. So the question here is that just fan service, as every other normal Robin clone that we saw had clothes on, or could that possibly mean that Robin doesn't have as much control on the giant clone as she has on the normal sized ones, so the clothes don't manifest. Either way, we will see if the Robin clone will be naked or will have clothes, probably next chapter. Moving on to the last scene of the chapter, we have Luffy's reunion with Momo on the shores of Tokage Port. After Luffy ate all the meat in the submarine, they resurfaced in order to find more meat for Luffy to eat so he could recover. That way, they bumped into Momo and Shinobu, who used Shinobu's kite after falling down from Onigashima to glide down to the ground. We have a conversation with Luffy and Momo, where Luffy encourages Momo to stop crying for what happened with Kiko and Kinemon, as the fight is not over yet. While this is going on, we see a character who is speaking on this situation at the shore. The character in question is none other than Karibu, who stayed this whole time in Wano, hiding and waiting for Luffy to beat Kaido so he could escape Wano. As for his purpose there, it's pretty obvious that after they find Karibu, they will use him, as he probably has a bunch of food stored inside of him to give to Luffy so he can recover. The only question then that remains is Karibu's role in this arc to play the refrigerator for Luffy, or will he do something apart from this? Considering his nature and involvement, I doubt it. For the last scene of the chapter, Luffy tells Momo that he will carry him back to Onigashima so that Luffy can resume his fight with Kaido. And on this predictable scenario, we end this chapter. This chapter had an unpredictable beginning with Yamato's fruit being revealed. It had a good solid middle with Robin, Brook and Black Maria's fight, which highlighted how much Robin has changed since Water 7. And it ended on a rather predictable plan on how Luffy is going to reach Onigashima again. When we're on the topic of Onigashima, everybody believes that the climax of this arc will happen when Onigashima will be above the Flower Capital or somewhere close, but with the speed it's going, it will take Onigashima 100 or so chapters to reach the Flower Capital, as it took it 22 chapters to barely pass the Tokage Port. Maybe I'm exaggerating by saying that it will take 100 chapters to reach the Flower Capital, but the fact of the matter is that Onigashima is moving pretty damn slow, with the Flower Capital not being close in the least. All in all, this was a good chapter of One Piece. Hopefully, we'll get the finale of Robin vs. Black Maria next chapter. And that will be all for this video. If you like this video, leave a like, leave your thoughts in the comments below, or subscribe to the channel for more One Piece content, as well as other manga content. And until next time, take care.